next item of business is a motion to approve a statutory rule. Clerk, please read the motion.
That the draft Renewable Heat Incentive Schemes Amendment Regulations Northern Ireland 2016 be approved.
I call the Minister of Enterprise, Trade and Investment.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I beg to move. This statutory rule is being made under Section 113 of the Energy Act 2011, which prescribes that these regulations must be laid in draft for approval by affirmative resolution of the Assembly. I'll begin with the technicalities of the legislation. These regulations amend the Renewable Heat Incentive Scheme Regulations Northern Ireland 2012, or what I'll refer to as the 2012 regulations, and the Domestic Renewable Heat Incentive Scheme Regulations Northern Ireland 2014, the 2014 regulations. The 2012 regulations established a renewable heat incentive scheme for the non-domestic sector, and the 2014 regulations, a renewable heat incentive scheme for the domestic sector. The amendments made to the 2012 and to the 2014 regulations give the department power to issue a notice suspending the scheme to new applications. The power arises where it appears to the department that it does not have or is not likely to have sufficient funds available to it for the purpose of meeting the full cost of payments under both schemes. It is important to highlight that the purpose of these regulations is to establish the power for the department to suspend the RHI in the circumstances I've described. They do not in themselves close the schemes. Closure requires a notice to be issued suspending the schemes from a particular date. I appreciate that the majority of those involved in the schemes will be anxious for clarity on closure. So to confirm the position, if the Assembly passes this legislation, I will issue a notice closing both schemes to new applications from 29th of February. The period of time since I announced my intention to close the schemes on the 5th of February gives those who are in the process of installing renewable heat equipment effectively the month of February to complete installation before the scheme closes. This reflects a reasonable balance between the need to manage scheme expenditure and give those people who are in the process of installation time to make the decisions on whether to proceed. I've listened to the concerns raised about immediate closure of the scheme, and that is why, with the agreement of the First and Deputy First Minister, I have decided to defer closure for a further 2 weeks. I have no doubt that there are a range of views on closure. At one end of the spectrum, there are those who are not convinced that we should be subsidising expensive renewable technologies. On the other hand, there are those who believe we should be investing more in the future of renewables. So the speed of closure of the RHI can be debated either way. However, to anyone who intends to oppose this legislation, I have to sound an important warning. Opposing this legislation means opposing the ability to suspend the scheme at all. This means continuing with an open-ended commitment to fund renewable heat, no matter what the cost. I cannot believe that, given the competing priorities for funding we face, it is tenable that we should give open-ended funding commitments. I apologise for repeating this point, but I want to make it absolutely clear that anyone who opposes this legislation is voting for an open-ended funding commitment. The nature of legislation, Mr. Allister, is that you get an unlimited time, I understand, to make your points. You will have your time, and I will answer those principles.
To address the chair.
Deputy Speaker, the member should be aware that he will have his period to make whatever points he wishes to make, and I'll have my period to consult on what he has to say and come back to him at the end of the period. So as I was saying, let me apologise for repeating this point, but I want to make it absolutely clear that anyone who opposes this legislation is voting for an open-ended funding commitment. The RHI scheme currently works to require government to fund all properly made applications for renewable heat installations. There is no choice but to make these payments, and no way of turning off or slowing down or phasing out if we do not pass this legislation. We can debate when the scheme should close, but unless we pass this legislation, that debate would be pointless. We would have no choice but to keep making payments regardless of the budgetary position. I'll now turn to deal with why we need to close the scheme. The Renewable Heat Incentive, RHI, introduced in November 2012 to the non-domestic sector and in December 2014 to the domestic sector, has been taken up very successfully. The non-domestic RHI incentivises the uptake of renewable heat technologies such as biomass, heat pumps and solar thermal installations. It provides payments for 20 years based on heat energy generated. The level of tariff is dependent on the size and type of technology and is calculated to cover capital costs, operating costs and non-financial hassle costs over the lifetime of the technology. The domestic scheme provides for upfront capital grants and 7 years support thereafter. Overall, with over 3,900 renewable heating installation incentivised to date, uptake has been higher than GB. We have exceeded the executive's PFG target of 4%, with around 6% of Northern Ireland's heating needs now provided through renewable heating technologies. We're on well on way to attaining the executive endorsed target of 10% renewable heat set out in the Strategic Energy Framework. This will contribute to the UK's target of 15% renewable energy by 2020, as required by the EU renewables directives. The focus during the initial period of the scheme was on trying to improve the performance of the RHI scheme to achieve the executive's PFG target and ensure that the renewable heating sector and the wider Northern Ireland economy benefited from this investment. To this end, advertising campaigns were conducted during 2013-14 and 2014-15, and the domestic scheme introduced at the end of 2014. This has resulted in increased scheme uptake, particularly, Deputy Speaker, over recent months. The total number of renewable heating installations under the non-domestic scheme increased from just over 250 to over 1,800 during the last 14 months. A significant and unexpected surge in applications occurred in the six-week run-up to the scheme changes in November 2015, which were intended to help manage demand. Over 900 applications were made in that short period. This, together with reductions in available funding, means we now face significant budgetary pressures. Both RHI schemes, non-domestic and domestic, are paid out of annually managed expenditure, which is in addition to Northern Ireland block grant funding. Normally, it would not have an impact on the Northern Ireland departmental expenditure limit DEL block funding. However, even though total renewable heating capacity through the NIRHI equates to over 6% of total capacity in the GB scheme, the Chancellor's autumn statement confirmed that an AMI cap for Northern Ireland would be set at the Barnett share of circa 3%. This means that the block DEL will have to meet any funding in excess of this. Total application numbers for the Northern Ireland non-domestic scheme are now exceeding our highest estimates, and this means that the available AMI budget for the next 5 years is now already committed to meeting payments for existing RHI installations. Therefore, in the circumstances, I have no choice but to move to close the RHI scheme to minimise further costs and impact on the Northern Ireland block. In bringing this course of action to the Assembly, I want to be clear how reluctant I am to close a scheme which brings such benefits in terms of jobs, investment, environmental protection, and meeting our renewable targets. Ensuring a more competitive and diverse heating market in Northern Ireland is therefore a key priority for me. We need to reduce our current reliance on fossil fuels. Heat from Indigenous and renewable sources must therefore be promoted. However, despite my support for RHI, and however beneficial the scheme, I have to acknowledge that we can't manage an executive budget on the basis of individual schemes taking off or incurring costs that were formerly funded from the UK without agreement. The executive has many other priorities demanding funding, and if we don't move to close the RHI, these will be put at increased risk. I do want to make the point, however, that some of the reaction to the closure of the RHI implies that money has been squandered or investment lost. This is not the case. The RHI has seen over £50 million brought into Northern Ireland over the last 4 years. This has gone to help some of our most important local industries, to bolster the rural economy, and to provide much-needed jobs. Existing scheme participants will continue to receive support for 20 years. Those who hope to avail of the scheme will naturally be disappointed, but let's not forget what benefits the scheme has brought. There has been allegations that there has been abuse of the scheme in some cases. I want to tell you, Deputy Speaker, I take these allegations very seriously. The evidence is not clear at the moment. I've asked officials to work with Ofgem, which administers the non-domestic scheme across the UK, to undertake extra checks and to look at existing processes to make sure that the scheme is operating in compliance with the legislation. An audit of internal procedures is also underway to assess management of the scheme and how it was set up to see where things could have been improved. However, I think we need to be careful when talking about abuse on how the scheme is operating. There will be many hard-working and committed households and businesses who have properly complied with the scheme, and it would be quite wrong to suggest that abuse is common without any evidence to back this up. To conclude, by looking to the future, I believe that the renewable sector can play a part in helping reduce our CO2 emissions and bring investment to our economy. I'm open to suggestions on how we might engage with developers and installers and others to see where we might go in the future on renewable heat. This might involve consulting on the long-term position, looking at developments in other jurisdictions or considering options. However, any debate, Deputy Speaker, on the future must take place in an environment where costs are controlled. The only way to ensure that is to support, however reluctantly, the suspension of the scheme at this time. Deputy Speaker, I ask members to support the regulations.
I call the chairperson of the Committee for Enterprise, Trade and Investment, Mr. Patsy McGlone.
Thanks very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his contribution. The first official notification that the Committee had of these proposals was through papers from the Department, which were tabled at last week's Committee meeting on Tuesday, the 9th of February. The proposals were for an immediate closure of the scheme, following agreement by this Assembly today, the 15th of February. As the Committee had no prior notification of the proposals, it could not engage in proper scrutiny and was only able to note the statutory rule. This statutory rule therefore comes to the House without proper scrutiny of the proposals as laid down in Standing Order 43.1. It is important, however, that I provide the House with details of the Committee's scrutiny of the Renewable Heat Incentive and of the Committee's limited consideration of the SR. I want to start by putting on record a very brief history of the Committee's consideration of the Renewable Heat Incentive. On the 11th of April 2013, the Committee asked for the Department to provide biannual updates on the implementation of the scheme. This resulted in an update being received more than 1 year later, on the 5th of June 2014, and a further written briefing 5 months after that on the 4th of November 2014. Since that time, the Department has not considered it necessary to provide further progress reports or updates to the Committee, despite those requests for updates on a twice-yearly basis. It is important to make clear from the outset how the renewable incentive works. The point of application is after the installation is complete. Once a valid application has been received, that application must be supported. Therefore, both the supplier and the customer have already invested considerable numbers of money and amounts of money, often taking out loans, in the expectation that they will be able to complete their installations and make an application before the 31st of March. While the latest proposal to close the scheme on the 29th of February may alleviate the problem for some people, the question still remains. How many businesses and individuals who have already invested considerable sums of money will be affected? And we've all, as MLAs, received those details in our emails and in phone calls to our constituency offices. And to what extent by the decision to close the scheme early? The Minister's letter, which accompanied the draft regulations, referred to the very serious and urgent risk to public finances, and we've heard more of it today. But the question remains for the Committee. Should the problem have been recognised sooner, and could steps have been taken at an earlier stage to manage those risks? The briefing to the Committee in June 2014 stated that, quote, the current NI uptake compares favourably with the GB uptake at the same point in time on a pro rata basis, and this suggests that the Northern Ireland RHI could experience a higher volume of applications but for smaller installations. Projecting forward, it could be expected that around 300 applications could be received by the end of March 2015. The briefing to the Committee 6 months later, and I'm quoting from departmental documents here, I have them with me. The briefing to the Committee 6 months later in November 2014 stated, quote, as of the 15th of October 2014, in brackets, Ofgem have received 308 applications. So, in November 2014, applications had already exceeded expectations for March 2015. Should this have started alarm bells ringing? Officials then informed the Committee last week that the process of thinking about this issue and asking questions began in March 2015, when it was noticed that the level of applications was rising. This was 3 months after the Department informed the Committee off the very same fact. Officials said the Minister was formally made aware of the problem in July 2015, July last year. This was followed by a consultation which issued on the 22nd of July, which contained proposal to introduce, among other things, demand measures from November 2015. Given the fact that demand had exceeded expectations and that this had been apparent from at least as far back as November 2014, did anyone in the department try to work out the impact of the announcement or to think to at least ask the question, what impact will this July announcement have on the level of applications between now and the introduction of new measures in November? In the 6 weeks running up to the introduction of the legislation, there were 900 applications. Last week, officials acknowledged that, although a spike in applications was expected, the extent of the spike was not known until later. Was it not reasonable to assume that there would have been a considerable spike, and how much time and effort did the department put in to calculating what that spike could conceivably be? Although the department was aware in September past that it had a financial problem, they said that they committed to a course of action which could not be changed until November, because that's the way they said that's the way the legislative process works. However, this is not the way the legislative process has worked in this instance, this evening, as we see. The committee raised the issue that there was a belief within the industry that tariffs would be in place until the 31st of March 2016. However, officials dismissed this as speculation, stating that there was no announcement to that effect. The legislation, which was introduced in November past, stated, and members were shown it at the meeting, the legislation introduced in November past stated that the tariffs would be in place until the 31st of March 2016. This suggests more than a mere speculation. It's in the text of the statutory rule at paragraph 10.3a, 31st of March 2016, not 15th of February 2016, not 29th of February 2016, but 31st of March 2016. Now, would this deadline in the text of the legislation not have raised a reasonable expectation within the industry and indeed within householders that this was the deadline to which they could work in order to avail of the current tariff levels? Can the department explain how the tariff runs until the 31st of March, but the scheme ends on the 29th of February? Bizarre. When it was put to officials last week, they agreed that it would be reasonable to infer that this reference in the statutory rule would raise the expectation that applications at this level would be received until that date. They said that it would be reasonable to expect that to run until that date. However, as officials put it, there was an overriding issue of preventing a further increase in the financial pressure faced by the department. When questioned about the failure to follow proper procedures, officials stated that the department had been looking at how to resolve the issue since December, and to have opened the problem up at an earlier stage would in itself have carried the risk of increased applications. They said it, I didn't. They said the previous spike had occurred because people had had time to consider and make applications, which is usually the whole idea behind a scheme. When the legislation came into effect last November, announcing the tariffs would apply until the 31st of March 2016, would it not have been reasonable to assume, given recent history, that there would be a further spike in applications before the 31st of March deadline? Officials said that if they had gone through proper procedures and had come to the committee, that would have allowed for a time for a spike that was coming because people had been anticipating the March deadline anyway, since a consultation had been brought forward last July for legislation that was introduced last November. They knew about the date. Is it the case that the department has now only anticipated that a further spike during March and has decided, without regard to the consequences for jobs, businesses, homes and the environment, to close the renewable heat incentive to avoid facing that spike? As I said, the department acknowledged that it was reasonable for homeowners and the industry to expect that the scheme would run until the 31st of March, given that this was the date up until which the tariffs were valid. The committee has received considerable correspondence from industry representatives, and indeed as we all as individual MLAs, about the impact of this legislation on their businesses and on jobs. And just I was listening to the Minister earlier about this, just for, I'll give him a few examples here, obviously he hasn't heard them. For example, one business has indicated that if it stops work now, it will lose over £100,000 in committed supplies and equipment. But if it keeps on working, jobs that are already in place will not be covered by the scheme. It stands to lose over £1 million and 25 jobs. Another business informed the committee that it has a large number of clients who have borrowed money for investing in renewable heating systems that are partway through installation, and repayments have been calculated to banks and other lending institutions on the strength of obtaining payments under the scheme. The businesses say that the client will not pay for work currently being installed if they cannot obtain the RHI. One supplier company has invested over £600,000 in stock for projects, and other members will be aware of this too. That will probably be cancelled as a result of closure, and the business is now in threat of going into administration. That's the harsh reality of this unusual decision. When officials were questioned about the impact of closure on people who took business decisions to buy in stock to develop schemes on the strength of the renewable heat incentive, the committee was told that would be a matter for themselves. When asked if any consideration was given to the economic implications and whether any consideration was given to putting the proposals out to consultation, the committee was informed that the options were considered and a judgment made that the need to stem the flow of uncovered expenditure was the overriding consideration. When asked about the uncovered liabilities for those businesses which have already invested in stock for unfinished projects and whether they have been left high and dry, officials stated that the potential consequences were part of the analysis, that all factors were considered and there is no provision to compensate any business or individual affected. When questioned in more detail about the Department's assessment of the economic implications of the proposals, officials said they had limited information on this because it's hard to predict the level of applications. However, officials were able to say that if the scheme was left open until the end of March, it would roughly double the pressures over the next 5 years. In other words, predicting the level of applications. The department must therefore have made some assessment of the level of applications it could have anticipated up until the end of March. How difficult would it have been to have used this measure to estimate the impact of early closures on jobs, businesses and the economy? When questioned about the risk of a legal challenge to the legislation, officials informed the committee that the Minister is aware of the risk of challenge and that the analysis presented to the Minister included analysis of the risk. What I have is a question. What was the analysis of the risk that this decision will be challenged? And was the view taken that it would be less expensive to face legal challenge than to continue with the scheme? That is a risky one. Committee members also questioned officials about any safeguards that could have or should have been put in place to protect businesses and to protect the department's budget. The department provides preliminary accreditation for very large applications, however, there have been very few of these. Preliminary accreditation is provided before the plant is built, but it only applies to plants over 200 kilowatts, which take a lot longer to plan with a lot more finance involved. Officials said that smaller installations do not have that facility because they don't need it. I bet you there's a whole lot of them out there today. Many, a few hundreds of them, wish they had that protection. However, how many people, the questions arise, how many people are there out there now who wish they had exactly that facility to avail of? Would such a facility, or even a facility, for preliminary notification, which would give advance warning that there's going to be an application coming, have given the department some sort of an earlier indication of what it could expect? Well, and this leads me on to the next part of the process, which was exactly that type of management. Officials were questioned on the demand management measures which have been put in place in GB and why similar measures weren't put in place here. In GB, in a process known as digression, an assessment of applications is set out against a budgetary position. And if applications are approaching certain budgetary levels, then the tariff is automatically lowered to dampen demand. However, this wasn't implemented here. Officials said that it was not considered because the scheme was underperforming and resources were limited. And here you are. Not exactly that now. I think those questions that need to be asked, why wasn't this option revisited in November 2014, when it was seen that the applications were over 3 months ahead of expectations? Why wasn't it? Yep, sure.
Well, when that original consideration took place on the digression model, the department stated to the committee that they had other priorities, that the domestic scheme was the priority. It suggests they can't manage two priorities.
I thank the member for members well across this, and I do thank him for his expertise in this area. Obviously, it raises that question too. You know, why? What was going on over there? Again, why wasn't it revisited when an increase in demand became evident in March 2015? And why wasn't it included in the consultation that issued on 22nd of July 2015, effectively mentioned in the document they issued on September 2015? The requirement for it, the need for it, gone, not there. The Permanent Secretary outlined details of an audit that the Department would be undertaking of the scheme. This will consider whether the scheme was adequately designed to cope with an unprecedented increase in demand. It will look at whether there were administrative errors. It will examine whether the budget situation may have been clarified at an earlier stage. There is also an issue of DFP approval, which was missed for a deadline to seek reapproval for the non-domestic scheme, and the audit will check that there has been no breach and obligation of the scheme there too. So, not a happy picture over at the department we're seeing. The Permanent Secretary informed the committee that as accounting officer he has concerns about the scheme and will make sure it is examined objectively and transparently, which is why this audit is being conducted on his behalf. Given the short time until dissolution, the outcome of this audit is something the Committee for the Economy will no doubt wish to consider, and it is a matter which the Committee will want to include in its legacy report. Deputy Speaker, I said at the outset the Committee was given very little time to consider this highly complex and very controversial issue. It is also evident from my contribution that the evidence from the Department has raised many, many more questions for the Committee and others indeed out with this chamber than it has answered, which is why the committee was only able to note the statutory rule. Now, just in summation, a few words in my capacity as SDLP member. In a constituency where a number of these businesses are located, many feel let down, deeply let down. Indeed, some of the business organisations that have been in touch with me feel that this is an issue of honour. If they can't plan with certainty on government decisions, Why depend on an executive? Why rely on an executive? Why even make those decisions around investment if those commitments that have been given on behalf of government, Deputy in this case, just are fly by night and disappear like snow of a ditch back without any notification or whatever to those people? The issue of trust is certainly lost with businesses out there and others who wanted to engage in the scheme and wanted to contribute to protection of the environment. People who took out loans, invested in stock, committed to the environment as they were. Who will compensate those people for the investment? Who will compensate them for job losses as a consequence? Who will compensate people who took out loans in good faith? It really is an unmitigated mess. Gurna Mayagad, Alaskan Corlia, thank you. We'll leave it at that.
I call Gordon Dunn.
Speaker, the Renewable Heat Incentive Scheme, which was established in 2012 for the non-domestic sector and in 2014 for the domestic sector, was designed to encourage the use of renewable energy. It was designed to help Northern Ireland meet its targets set out within the programme for government, as well as the 10% European target by 2020. In November 2015, new tariffs were introduced for combined heat and power to coincide with the changes to the Nairo and the ROCs. With this change in tariffs, the demand spiked in November, with 900 applications within 6 weeks. The success of this scheme is underlined with the fact that the PFG target of 4% of our total heating needs being provided through renewable technologies have been exceeded, and it is now estimated to be around 6%. Both of these RHI schemes have been paid out of the annual managed expenditure, which wouldn't normally impact upon our block funding. However, the Chancellor's autumn statement in November confirmed that the AME cap for us would be set out as the Barnett formula, or around 3%, meaning that the block deal would be penalised for any excessive spend. Total expenditure by Northern Ireland for both schemes in 2015-16 is now forecast to exceed £30 million, plus £18.2 million from the AME, a considerable investment indeed. The success of these schemes has resulted in the budget being exceeded. These are issues that raise a number of questions on how the scheme was managed when tariffs were changed in November. I would question why Derry officials did not bring a submission to the Minister when price controls were established in GB. This would have enabled us to manage the budget in the way GB have managed it. Derry officials did put in place a scheme to manage tariffs against the demand, but fund limits were soon exceeded. Perhaps the Minister could advise us as to when the Department had confirmation that it wasn't going to be met out of the AME budget. We have also the situation with two bodies, Ofgem based on the mainland, who are responsible for managing the operation on the ground in Northern Ireland, and Derry being responsible for managing the strategy, policy, administration of the scheme. Having two separate bodies creates a risk in itself. Also, we understand the regulators Ofgem did not have inspectors based in Northern Ireland. Instead, we're relying on subcontractors, which to my mind creates a potential risk. The Department's officials at last week's committee stated it was aware of a number of issues in relation to control and verification. Therefore, they plan to carry out a review and audit of the processes and procedures to establish any evidence of non-compliance or otherwise. There is no doubt there has been genuine concern, as outlined by the previous speaker, within the renewable sector around the enforced early closure, particularly for those who have planned new schemes working towards the end of March deadline. However, it is important that the Department does what it can to support these businesses in this difficult time resulting from the proposed closure on the 29th of February. Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
I call Conor Murphy.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Can I endorse the comments that were made, the account that was given by our committee chair, Patsy McGlone, in relation to the treatment of the committee in this matter, the way the announcement and the consequences of the announcement were bounced onto the committee at very short notice, and the restriction that placed on the committee's ability to properly scrutinise this decision and any process by which this scheme would be suspended. Can I also add to the commentary that he made in relation to it that this notion, again, was floated kind of in general terms by the Minister when he was making his opening contribution of some perhaps irregularities or some abuse of the scheme and in the system. And I have to say, the senior officials that came before the Department were questioned in relation to this. And the Minister says there is no clear evidence in relation to this. The senior officials said they had no evidence whatsoever in relation to any abuses. Now, there may be complaints made and inquiries into it, but I wouldn't like that to hang as a backdrop, as a rationale for the decision taken here today. There's something untoward going on. It was a clear statement from the most senior officials in the Department that they had heard no evidence that there was any abuse going on. There is absolutely no doubt this scheme has been very, very badly handled by the Department itself. Its operation has run very seriously over budget, which threatens not only the Department's finances and the Department's core function of growing the economy, but also the Executive's finances to the tune of, we are told, some £95 million over the next 5 years, and tens of millions of pounds thereon for future years. Money the Executive has not budgeted for, and money to be found, which will undoubtedly impact on the executive's priorities, such as protecting frontline services. And I acknowledge and appreciate the points made by Mr Dunn in relation to the sudden announcement of the British Chancellor, George Osborne, in relation to the cap on the AMI money, and that was a serious blow, obviously, to the Department's ability to finance the scheme. Yes, sir.
I thank the member for giving way. When Arlene Foster first announced this scheme in 2012, she described it as a £25 million scheme. That suggests to me that there was always a cap and that this wasn't news.
I thank the member for his point. The officials put forward the notion that the announcement in November by the Chancellor, which and contributed to the difficulty in which the department found in terms of management. But what I was going to go on to say was it was very clear from the evidence that they give our committee, and the member was there last Tuesday morning, that the scheme was already being run in a way which wasn't sustainable. As I say, I acknowledge that decision contributed to the difficulties, but certainly the way the scheme has been run and managed and conceived made it not sustainable. And again, that's something that people in the industry have told us, because we have all been consulting with people in the industry over the last week, told us that they had made clear to the department that it was not a sustainable scheme. I am glad, and I do acknowledge the Minister's decision to provide a variation from his original plan, which was to propose to shut down the scheme immediately, that has given, after representation, has given a further 2 weeks. And I have spoken to people in the industry who say that will allow a number of schemes to be completed and applications to be processed. However, it's clear, and many members will have evidence of this, that there are still those who are operating on the basis, certainly, that the scheme is going to continue until the end of March, and they do stand to lose investment already made, and potentially jobs will be at risk or lost as a consequence of the Department's action. And I would ask the Minister and the Department to undertake an assessment of all schemes which have already begun work, and to see can these schemes be honoured within the system as it's been proposed to be brought to suspension and closure. We are now faced in the Assembly with a Hobson's choice. The question is of potentially damaging some companies, and that has been alluded to, who have invested in the Renewable Heat Initiative scheme, or creating an even larger hole in the executive's finances for years to come, which could damage all sectors of the economy, as well as impacting on the delivery of public services. And I sincerely hope, and we had the department officials, as I say, last week in front of the ETI committee, they give a commitment to examine what went wrong in relation to this scheme, but I sincerely hope that a very long and hard look is taken within the department and appropriate lessons are learnt. And I did have the opportunity at the Public Accounts Committee meeting to speak to the Controller and Auditor General, and I understand that they have an interest in how this was being managed as well. Minister and Mr Deputy Speaker, the renewables industry is now facing a very dismal and uncertain future as a consequence, not just of the actions of DEDI in relation to this scheme, but what is coming down the tracks potentially in relation to the wind energy schemes also. And undoubtedly the incoming executive in the new mandate will have a responsibility to devise new schemes which are sustainable and meet the executive's targets for renewable energy. And I hope that we can, in doing that, give some degree of hope and some degree then of certainty to those involved in the renewables industry, because there is a huge amount of frustration and dismay out there at the way these schemes have been handled and the potential cost to that industry. People were saying to us that the industry is in effect closed down now. I think we have a responsibility in this House in trying to clean up the mess that is at the tail end of this scheme, of offering some optimism that we can, in a new mandate with a new executive, put together proper sustainable schemes for renewable energy and deliver those in a way which not only supports our targets of a cleaner and greener energy supply, but also supports those involved in that industry and sustains economic development in that regard.
I call Adrian Cochrane-Watson.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker. Delhi's enterprise policy states, promoting enterprise and entrepreneurship and creating the necessary conditions that will enable businesses across sectors of the economy to start and to grow. What we have in front of us today is a story of failure, incompetence and ignorance in devolved government, for one which there must be consequences. I agree entirely with the committee chair, Mr. Patsy McCrone, and he has went through the detail in very clear fashion of the embarrassment which we witnessed last Tuesday. It's worth reflecting on how we got to where we are today. RHI is a UK government scheme set up to encourage uptake of renewable heat technologies through financial incentives. UK government expects RHI to contribute 12% by 2020, and our own devolved government through programme for government set a target of 10%. It was launched on the 1st of November for the non-domestic sector, and on October 2012, introducing RHI for the non-domestic sector, the then Deputy Minister Foster said, financial incentives have already been successful in the local renewable electricity market. Since the introduction of NARO in 2005, the level of electricity generated from renewables has increased from 3 to 14%. It is now vital that a similar commitment is made for the renewable heat market. It's expected that the RHI will support the installation of over 20,000 technologies by 2020, as well as securing our target to have a level of 10% renewable heat. Minister Foster announced the extension of RHI to domestic customers on the 3rd of October. That's the background. Minister Bell, in taking up office in May 2015, and on the 17th of November, the Minister brought forward to the House an amendment to the regulations, introducing a second tier of lower payments for small and medium biomass systems. The tariffs were clearly set for a period beginning with the 18th of November and ending on the 31st of March, a clear commitment to this sector. This led to a predictable and significant increase in applications in the run-up to this date of the new tariffs being introduced, and this did lock Deputy into a commitment over many years. But we heard nothing until Friday a week ago. At 6:02, a press release was issued in Minister Bell's name, stating the scheme had become massively oversubscribed and had to close almost immediately. Nothing happened between November and that Friday evening. Nothing happened between middle of November, when the spike happened, and that Friday evening in February. I will give way.
I thank the member for giving way. And does he agree that the spike was entirely predictable? So it's worse than nothing happening from November, because every time there was a tariff reduction in GB, there was a spike. Why would we anticipate anything different here?
I thank the member, and I agree with the member. Of course, we knew there would be a predicted spike on those applications trying to beat the change in tariff. But among the questions the minister must answer today, when did he first become aware that the scheme was massively oversubscribed and the money was running out? How did he and his department get the figures so wrong? Was the scheme initially involving too much incentives? Why did he announce the sudden closure in a press release after 6 p.m. on a Friday evening? And last Tuesday, at question time, yet again he blamed someone else. It was the Chancellor of the Exchequer's fault for moving the goalposts again in November. We heard nothing. But he stated, my department faces a huge budgetary pressure given the Chancellor of the Exchequer's decision to limit the amount of money paid to Northern Ireland out of the UK pot for renewable heat. However, detail included within the autumn statement also enclosed that the original allocated £860 million was to increase to £1.15 billion. However, there has been no details as yet as how that scheme will be reformed, and a consultation is expected soon. So will the Minister please explain why he is blaming Westminster? Or is he just doing what his colleagues in government, partners in government of the DUP, Sinn Féin, do so well, and that's blame the Brits? A Fermanagh company firm who I've been talking to, who are planning to install biomass boilers, say, we are currently struggling to compete with other UK-based manufacturers. They're receiving up to 5.6 pence per kilowatt RHI payment. on similar boilers, and yet the RHI tariff for Northern Ireland is 1.5 pence per kilowatt. That's less than a third, and the scheme is still open in GB. The Minister also said last week there will be an investigation into why we have found ourselves in this position, and I have, as a matter of urgency, asked my own officials to ensure that the scheme is running to the letter and spirit of the law. So if he is saying the scheme was wide open to fraudulent activity, is that what we are now going to be told? The Ulster Unionist Party will not support the statutory rule. The situation has arisen because of incompetence and ignorance of this sector. If government sets the rules on something, the public expect those rules to be adhered to, not changed at the drop of a ministerial hat. The Minister needs to take responsibility and sort it out. The original 31st of March deadline should be reinstated and honoured to this sector. He needs to agree, through consultation with the industry groups such as the Federation of Master Builders, a phased winding down period. This will allow businesses the opportunity to plan for the change in their revenue stream. Longer term, we also need to give some clarity and certainty to the whole area of renewable energy. Does he have a plan to replace RHI and the Nairo, or is the fledgling renewable sector in Northern Ireland going to be allowed to go to the wall? How are we going to meet the renewable 2020 targets of 10%? And will the Minister recognise that Delhi has made a mess of this issue? Delhi has been shown to be incompetent and ignorant of business in Northern Ireland, and that you as Minister need to take responsibility. The buck does stop with you, Minister. Will you, Minister, do a decent thing and consider your position?
I call Trevor Lum.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Not having a place on the Delhi Committee, of course, I haven't been privy to all the limited discussions and information that they have been given, but I did listen with interest to Mr. McGlone, and he's given me a pretty fair outline of what's happened over the last year, year and a half, and it doesn't make pretty listening, does it? I mean, somebody here has been asleep at the wheel. I don't know who to blame, but there appears to have been a complete lack of any forward planning or any anticipation of what was going on here. And it's a pity, because it's actually a good news, bad news story. It's good news because it's an excellent scheme, and a lot of people have already benefited from it, and a few more may before the thing closes down. But it's bad news by the fact that for all the concerns that people have out there about employment prospects within the industry, for a start. I must confess, Mr. Deputy Speaker, maybe I'm naive. I can't think of a scheme in my experience where you made application after the work was completed. Am I reading this right? That you don't actually have to notify in advance that you're going to commit the department to £10,000, £20,000, £30,000 worth of expenditure. You just throw in the bills after completion. That's hard to believe, frankly. And I was listening to the Minister with interest as well, and if I read correctly what he said, that there's enough applications already in the pipeline to deal with the budget or whatever money has been set aside and manageable money for the next 5 years. It's just, if there's no more comes in, we're still committed for 5 years to spending all this money. As others have said, companies have ordered in equipment. I'm getting the same emails as everybody else here. The householders who have perhaps part paid for a contract, are they going to be compensated? The companies have spent money apparently obtaining the necessary approval just to do this work in some cases, an MCS approval. I have one small company in Lisburn that's not on the scale of £1 million that Mr. McGlone talked about, but 8 employees and an order book of £185,000, which they expect to disappear. It just won't happen. None of that work, and they anticipate having to go to Scotland and elsewhere to look for work where the work is still available. Another point which I don't think anybody has yet mentioned is the fact that DEDI, the department involved here, has supported considerably some of the companies such as Dimplex and Warmflow, and the other one is Kingspan. who are heavily involved in this, supplying the equipment with Invest NI support through Invest NI from Derry, and so it goes on. This has been a, I think if I used the word it was in my mind, I'd probably get slung out, Mr. Speaker. It really is. And you said an unmitigated mess. That'll do. That's as far as we can go. Yes.
I'm grateful, Deputy Speaker, to the member. Would he also agree that it puts particularly smaller businesses in a very precarious place in managing and ordering in stock when they think a scheme's lasting a certain time? Even single traders and plumbers leaves all of those businesses in a very difficult state as to what, how to plan for the future, how to budget for the future.
Yes, I completely agree. I mean, I think we've all received something from Action Renewables today which indicates an immediate loss, potential loss of jobs, about 140 jobs, which you could, in the overall scheme of things, you might think is not as bearable. But the knock-on effect across all the other service and support industries is around 2,000 jobs. All this because the department didn't do its work anticipating properly, set up a scheme which, by the sound of it, was just too successful for its own good. And I wonder where we go from here. Now, the Minister has given us a dire warning that if we don't support this regulation today, that the scheme will run on out of control with catastrophic effects on the forward planning, on the budget, on the whole executive's expenditure plans. And I take that on board. But frankly, if he wants support from us, and he's not going to get it today, but if he wants support in the longer term, just a moment, he would have to be assuring me and my party colleagues that something is going to be set up here by way of a transitional arrangement, by way of a compensation scheme, to ensure that nobody, our companies supplying, companies performing the contracts, householders or business, anybody else who has committed money to this scheme, nobody can be left out of pocket by government action or government inaction. I'll give way to Mr. McGlone.
Thanks very much indeed, Mr. Lunn, for giving way. The scheme doesn't trundle on interminably, as in fact the Minister says. That's for the Minister to bring back fresh legislation around this. And I think what most of us are arguing here this evening is stick with what you said. Live up to the commitments that were given. And live up to the... That must be a few of those firms. They're waiting for us outside. live up to the commitments and comply with the date that they gave. That's what people worked to and committed their businesses to.
At least. Well, if I thank Mr. McGlone for that. If that means to stick to the date of 31st of March instead of the 29th of February, it doesn't sound like sufficient to me. You know, companies plan forward, they commit forward. It sounds like a very short timescale. My concern would be that companies on the back of this will obviously do what they can to mitigate their loss, but their loss could still be considerable if they've got a signed contract. And I really want to hear from the Minister when he responds here what his plans are to let people down gently. Let's put it that way. You can't just close this down, walk away, and it's too bad. It was a good scheme, but it's too good for its own good. We can't operate like that. So I will reserve judgment, but I don't know what the Minister could say, frankly, today that would make us vote in support of his proposition.
I call Martin O'Millier.
I rise with a heavy heart because it really is, as they say in Irish, Ray and Die You, the lesser of two evils, or Hobson's choice, because whatever decision we take today will ensure that some people lose out. Those certainly who are small companies who have brought in orders hoping to install renewable schemes, some people waiting to bring them into their businesses. But of course, if we don't take a decision today, then the hole in the budget gets bigger and the money available to us in the future from the block grant to build the economy is lesser. But I want to make one point which I think has come out from all the contributions from those who sit on the Economic and Enterprise Committee. That is that there's a pattern of the committee not being informed, not being properly brought up to date with what's happening in the department. This isn't the only issue. This is the most egregious example of us being kept in the dark. But for me, it isn't good enough. At meeting after meeting over the last 6-7 months, the chair has had to tell us that he hasn't received information in a timely fashion, or he hasn't received information at all. And for me, that shows a disrespect to the committee, which we really need to get beyond. And I'm not happy with that. And even though I will go into a different division lobby from the chair later on, I'm sure in this debate when it finishes, I think that disrespect towards the chair needs sorted out. And I implore the minister to sort it out, because it infects the entire relationship, which should be vigorous, vibrant. It should be constructive and positive between the committee and the department, even though, of course, we have a duty, Minister, to scrutinise what you do. But I want to make 3 points, and really, over recent days, I too have been lobbied by all sorts of people, including the social enterprise sector. Aisling Brady from the Donoughmore Community Association has been lobbying, because that's a community association which decided that going into renewables was a good idea, as government money is retracts, that perhaps they could have other enterprises, and they are going to be hit by this. The Federation of Master Builders, Gavin Maguire, was on as well, and even a private nursing home in North Belfast, which had planned to install this renewable heating scheme. So we're not blind to the pain that's out there. We're not blind to the real consequences of this. And in fact, when I spoke to the minister last Tuesday, after we had gone through a full 2-hour meeting about this debacle at the Enterprise Committee, I said to the minister, I implored him not to close the scheme today, and in fact he hasn't done that. There has been a compromise. We're getting to the end of the month, and while that isn't satisfactory for everyone, it does represent a compromise. But I think there are 3 points which sum it up for us, for those of us in Sinn Féin. One is that, without a doubt, I'll ask Ken Corley, this is a dog's dinner. This should never have been allowed to get to this situation. This is a scheme. The Renewable Heating Initiative was a scheme which got totally out of control. It seems to me that there was no one at the wheel. There was no one watching and giving advice in a timely fashion. That we, certainly as a committee, should have been told, but certainly the minister should have been told as well, at a much earlier date, that we had here a crisis in funding, and if we don't act, and we don't act immediately, then the crisis would just get worse. And I hope that we can learn from this. If a suspension does happen today, we come back in a new mandate with a fresh look at not only the Renewable Heating Initiative, but also with the rocks and the different problems we have around the renewable obligations as well. I want to, I suppose the only thing I can say to those in the sector who have been in touch with me over recent days is, first of all, we have fought for this compromise for the 2 weeks, but also that the sums are so huge. We are told that the difference in the budget is £95 million over 5 years, almost £20 million a year extra, because this scheme has grown much bigger than was ever intended. Because that represents such a blow to the executive and to our budget, especially to the economic development budget, that we have to make that Hobson's choice, that we have to decide to finish the scheme at the end of February, to suspend it, to go back and look at it again, because that means that we will then have money to build the economy, to stimulate the economy in the time ahead. This sector has been a boon to the entire economy, the renewable sector, and we hope to see it be enhanced, improve and do well in the time ahead. But when it comes to that choice, Alaska and Corlia, do we continue to spend money just in this sector on a scheme which has been mismanaged and got out of control, or are we trying now and cap it, rein it in? I think the choice for me is certainly we have to make that Hobson's choice, and we have to vote for the suspension of the scheme. I want to say finally, and I know the Minister will come back when we finish up, I think, Minister, the fact that you have to come here today shows the severity, the seriousness of this situation. And I really hope that your review, which you mentioned, and looking back at what happened, I do hope that lessons will be learned and have been learned. Without being overly cruel, I hope those responsible for monitoring this scheme are not responsible for monitoring any other renewable schemes. I really do hope that when we come forward with alternatives to the renewable heating initiative in the time ahead, that we can look back at this and say that this mess, and there's no other word for it, that this dog's dinner, that we will ensure it will not happen again, and that those responsible are brought to account. And for me, Minister, there's been some talk about perhaps there's something that's been skewed in the applications, but for me the blame lies, and I hate saying this, but the blame lies in the department. People were in over their head and didn't let us know in time. So I don't like criticising officials, but where the public purse is involved, I think we have to insist, Minister, that lessons are learned, and you come back to us at a future time and assure us that this will not happen again.
I call Fergal McKinney.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, and can I endorse the account of the committee? Awareness of this, or lack of awareness of it, as reflected by my colleague, Mr. Patsy McGlone. And can I also welcome the outlining of some of the issues as they reflect individuals. Mr. Lunn referred to the fact that Action Renewables had informed members, and I think it's important to reflect. Action Renewables was a respected organisation itself, has given evidence to the committee, and we've sought that. And I think it's worthwhile reflecting for the record in the House just what it has been saying. It sampled 14 different companies. Members will have got this, but I think it's important to read it into the record of the House. Surveyed 14 different companies, and it's saying basically that next year, in terms of projected pipeline work, there's £22 million of work which may now not go ahead. And just break that down by constituency, by the way, or three of the headline constituencies, just over £5 million in Upper Ban, £6 million in South Down, and nearly £16 million in Mid Ulster. As I say, it was 14 companies that were surveyed, but the organisation underscored that that had potential impacts on jobs up to about 140. So overall, we can see that that could rise to 2,000, or that's what they claim. As well as that, they're talking about working capital, and the stock, which is either being held or in transit here, is in around £3.6 million. The other implication, which I think is very important, it is what is the implication around renewable energy policy here, and what drivers will there now be in order to allow us to achieve what are the 2020 10% targets, if now the rocks are gone and this renewable heat incentive scheme is gone as well. It was reflected earlier on about the implications, the contradictory implications in terms of other companies that were encouraging to do this work and sell both internally here and export, and those are in receipt of Invest NI grants. So I think it's important that we ask some of those questions as well. I think the Chair reflected very well concerns that we should all have about how this scheme increased, but nothing was done. If that had been here alone, without the backdrop of what happened in England, when they experienced an increase, they took action to try and mitigate against those increases, but nothing was done here. And I don't know if that was during the time of the Minister in and out of his seat, but certainly that wasn't helpful. I have to say I do take issue with the Minister talking about abuse of this scheme on the one hand, and then within the same sentence saying, but I don't have any evidence. And if he thinks he's going to bring people here to the chamber, I think, certainly from our perspective, and ask us to endorse an allegation about abuse when he doesn't have any evidence of that nature at all, in fact, admits that he doesn't have any evidence, and he may now start searching for that evidence, I think he'll get a different response from us than the one he thinks he would like to get, or the one he'd like to get. Now, we're not going to accept a gun to our head proposition from the Minister on this issue. Work was not done. More explanations are needed, more mitigation should be forthcoming, and from the SDLP's perspective, we will not be responding to dire warnings. We want to see further action taken on this in terms of mitigations, sliding scale propositions potentially, but certainly not something that puts a gun to our head on a Monday afternoon in the chamber when this was brought late and when the department and the minister and others should have known so much more about it and done and alerted us at a much earlier stage.
Call Mr. Jim Mallister.
What a shambles, Deputy Speaker. It's hard to look at this otherwise than to acknowledge the gross departmental and thus ministerial mismanagement of this matter. If this situation had evolved under direct rule, couldn't you imagine the outcry, the allegations from those who tonight will seek to brush it all under the carpet by voting through what the minister wants, namely the DUP and Sinn Féin? Couldn't you imagine the outcry about ministers asleep at the wheel, eye off the ball, no interest in the job, more interested in something else, allowing things to get out of control, no thought for the people or the economy of Northern Ireland? Couldn't you hear it all? And yet every one of those things could be said in a situation where we're supposed to have caring, local, responsive devolution. And yet it is under that regime of supposedly caring, local, responsible devolution that this shambles has come to fruition. This was a scheme which in many ways was a win-win. The Westminster authorities were paying for it. It was coming out of the AMI funding. But it was so mismanaged that instead of following the provisions wisely taken elsewhere in GB, where you adjusted the tariffs with demand, it was simply run out of control. And then someone wakens up and decides, oh, this can't go on, as if it had nothing to do with them, as if they weren't the ones in charge of the scheme, as if they weren't the ones who were told last July that it was running in the wrong direction in terms of demand, as if they weren't the one who in November issued an indication with tariffs reducing that it would run to the end of March. You know, this wasn't some third party in some distant place that failed to control this. This was supposedly hands-on local minister. Whatever he was doing, he hadn't his eye on this ball. Wherever he was, China or wherever, he wasn't looking after the shop as far as this scheme was concerned. And now he comes almost as if it's nothing to do with him. It is everything to do with him. And sadly, as far as the consequences are concerned, it's everything to do with many of our constituents who are going to pay the price of the incompetence that has been manifested here. I'm sure we've all been inundated with constituents and difficulties. I have two families I think of who, because of the peculiar nature of their scheme, are having to wait for custom-built stoves, which won't be available till the middle of March. The work has started, expenditure has been committed, but the custom-built stoves can't be provided till the middle of March. So courtesy of this unilateral drawing of a pen across a page and saying nothing from the end of February, they are simply expected to bear all of that loss. Well, I do have to say, when government conducts itself in the manner in which this scheme evolved, it creates a reasonable expectation. A reasonable expectation to those who come to avail of the scheme, that the scheme will be there to be availed of. And when the minister reaffirmed a deadline of the 31st of March, he created such a reasonable expectation. And now he wants to unilaterally pull it away. I do suspect that some of this matter will end up before the courts, because in public law, the creation of reasonable expectation is a very important principle. And I suspect that he may learn more about that as matters unfold. I think of constituents, a supplier in the Ballymena area, who forward planning, as businesses are meant to do, looked at the orders he had, has ordered in the stoves, and is going to be left sitting with them. A huge outlay because of the incompetence of a department and a minister. So all that stock that he will have to pay for, lost to him. And then we wonder why small and medium-sized businesses find it so tough. And then we hear all the platitudes and the sound bites from Detty about how they're the friend of business, here to help SMEs. Well, they're crucifying SMEs with this measure. That's what's happening. So I do say to the minister, the very least he can do to make some amends for that which has been mishandled to date is to have some transitional arrangements in place so that those who have not contributed to this but are going to suffer greatly in consequence of it have their situation ameliorated. He really does need to put in place some transitional arrangement and funding to cover that. Yes, I'll give way.
Would the member agree with me that for the department to inform the committee last week, they had no consultation with the sector. They didn't know how many jobs were at risk. They didn't know how many businesses were at risk. They actually don't have a clue about this sector. Would the minister agree that's totally unacceptable and it shows a lack of leadership and vision from within the department?
Well, this member will agree. I doubt if the minister will agree. But I certainly will agree about that. I do think it's one of the worst manifestations we've seen of mismanagement and bungling at a departmental level of a scheme which those who took it up in good faith, believing they were working with responsible government and that they could trust that which it said in the small print, that this was a scheme open until the 31st of March. And to now find that they can't do that and that it's going to cost them hugely. I trust they well remember who to blame for that. And the people to blame for that are the two parties which I evidently are going to ram through this proposal tonight. Thank you.
Mr. Stephen Agnew.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. And we have in front of us today the latest in a list of failures by this department and successive ministers when it comes to renewable energy. First, we had in 2014 the loss of a £1 billion offshore wind development under the previous minister, Arlene Foster, 400 megawatts of renewable energy to be produced, the only for Northern Ireland, but bigger than anything proposed across the UK. We lost that because the then Minister and her department did not fight to save it, and we accepted that that scheme was lost, that that investment was lost, and that those jobs were lost. Then we had a new minister who was going to stand up for the renewable energy industry. And when DEC introduced changes to the renewable obligation certificate, our minister said, no, we will not have those changes in Northern Ireland. And he gave a commitment to the businesses in Northern Ireland that we would not see the early closure here. Then the DEC minister stepped in and said, oh yes, you will. And the minister buckled, and that scheme is to close early. And now we had another commitment. New tariffs, a reduction in the RHI, which I think was acceptable. I don't think there was a huge outcry about. And he said those reductions, this new tariff, will be in place till the 31st of March. And again, we have a rollback in that commitment. And we do have to wonder, when this minister makes a commitment to the renewables industry, whether or not we should take heed of it at all. It's almost as if, Mr. Deputy Speaker, we're coming down with jobs in Northern Ireland, that we can afford to play so fast and loose with the one industry that throughout the recession grew, through the one industry that we have the skills and the tools in Northern Ireland to meet the needs of. Engineering, manufacturing, these are what we are steeped in Northern Ireland. I'll give way to the member.
Will the member also accept that with the downturn in the construction industry, many of those people who were associated with the construction industry sought gainful employment in this particular sector and carved out a niche for themselves of, well, they became very specialist in it in some of our areas?
The member is absolutely right, and in fact many have retrained, and I know the South Eastern Regional College, Ards campus, focus on many of the skills needed to work in this sector. So people have retrained with the anticipation, with the commitment from government. I go back to this word commitment, because that's what was given. Commitment to the sector, commitment to those workers, and indeed a commitment to those in education who saw the future in renewables and invested their time and energy in retraining to take part in this industry. And now that commitment's being withdrawn, and we're being asked to support that withdrawal here today. The RHI was about ending our dependence on fossil fuels, which are polluting, which are depleting, and which have ever fluctuating costs. We were told in the committee that it's okay to close this now. We've overreached our target for 4% in 2015, ignoring again the commitment that was made to reach a 10% renewable heat by 2020. The scheme was announced by Arlene Foster in 2012, and we were told then this is a £25 million investment. This was money that came directly from the Westminster government at no cost to our block grant. All we had to do in Northern Ireland was effectively administer a scheme that had been established by the Westminster government, was being funded by the Westminster government. We simply had to administer it. But despite this, we still managed to have a £25 million scheme, a £30 million overspend. That is a shambles. That is serious financial mismanagement. And indeed, when I questioned the officials at the committee and asked when was this decision made? Why did we not follow the model which will continue in the rest of the UK? We will be the only part of the UK not to have a renewable heat incentive. Why is it continuing to operate there and not here? What did they do differently? Why is their scheme sustainable and ours unsustainable? I was told, well, they had this system whereby if demand went up, we reduced the tariffs to manage demand and keep it sustainable. And I asked, why did we not do that? Seems sensible. Our priority was to introduce the domestic scheme. This department can only cope with one priority. Where is the capacity? Where was the management from then Minister, Ms Foster, to meet the workload of the department with the resources that were required? Because that model would have saved our scheme, that model would have prevented the £30 million overspend, and we wouldn't be in the crisis we're in today. And it's very worrying, because if the department could only manage one priority in terms of this scheme, there are many priorities coming forward. There's the review of the strategic energy framework. There's the need to firstly resolve the issue of the renewable obligation certificates, and then to work out what we do when they come to an end. There's the energy bill, which didn't come forward in this mandate, but is expected in the next mandate. Does the department have the capacity to deal with these issues effectively? Does it have the capacity to deal with them competently? I think that's a question we're perfectly entitled to ask. So it's now been proposed that this scheme, or it was proposed, the announcement was made on late in a Friday, or early in a Friday evening, late afternoon, that it would close with immediate effect. And then we have a further announcement that, well, we'll extend it for 2 weeks. And I do wonder, was that always the plan? Say, give the worst case scenario, and then say, well, it's okay, we'll give you 2 weeks and hope that you'll dissipate some of the anger, some of the frustration, some of the annoyance. But I think it's too late for this. The way people have been treated, I don't think any resolution is going to quell the disquiet. The commitment was given that the tariffs would be in place till the 31st of March, and people had a reasonable expectation that that is what would happen. The Minister also tells us that if we vote no today, there's no other option. And if I ever hear that I'm ever being told that there's no other option, I will find that other option. Because there always are alternatives. There are always options. One option for the Minister would have been to put a date on this statutory rule so that we could debate the date, and if rejected, he could come back with an alternative proposal. And he still indeed has that option, should this be rejected today, to come back with an alternative proposal. There are options. There is a choice. And I certainly cannot choose the option being presented by the Minister. And I think further, the Minister exposed his ambivalence, and indeed I suspect the Executive's ambivalence in supporting renewables. Because he said, well, some people think we support renewables too much. Some people think we don't support it enough. So we've supported it a bit, and if we close this now, well, isn't that meeting everybody in the middle? It's one way to look at it. Or the Minister could show leadership. He could adhere to his commitments and his predecessor's commitments to the renewables industry and say not no, well, there's two sides to the argument, but say there's one side that I will stand for, and that's that renewables is the way forward in terms of our heat production, in terms of our electricity production, in terms of creating jobs and backing a growing industry in this society. But I think he has exposed the lack of commitment. Because I've said this all along about the RHI scheme. This was funded by the UK government. It wasn't in itself showing the commitment of the executive. It was simply saying, well, if there's free money, yes, we'll take it. A commitment would be saying, this scheme has been successful. This scheme has overreached the demand now, still maintain it's been badly managed and we shouldn't have this degree of overspend. But a commitment would be to say, we've made a commitment to the 31st of March. We will fund those schemes. We will see out the Renewable Heat Initiative, Renewable Heat Incentive. And we will spend the extra money in renewables. Because, yes, thank you for the £25 million from the UK government. But we will invest Northern Ireland money in renewables. And, yes, £30 million, a lot of money. It was also a lot of money when we extended, when we committed £32.5 million to gas infrastructure to bring gas to the west. So it's not unheard of that we will invest these sums of money in energy infrastructure. And whilst the Minister might point to costly renewables, as he put it, well, just remember how costly the gas industry has been in terms of subsidies for gas to the west, in terms of subsidies for the gas network, in terms of subsidies for the boiler replacement scheme. It's not all about renewables. We subsidise energy because it's part of our infrastructure, and renewables is a key part of that. So I call on the Minister to withdraw his proposal to meet the commitment to and continue the scheme till at least the 31st of March. I call, assuming there's the capacity to do so, for a deep review of this scheme, an exhaustive review, and for it to come back. Because yes, there is absolutely flaws in how this scheme has been run, but the principles of the scheme are right. The technology is right. Those businesses deserve supporting. So that review must take place and the scheme must be reinstated in a sustainable way, because it's about sustainable energy. We need sustainable funding. Because alternatively, the Minister will have to compensate those companies. It will likely take legal proceedings. And that was clear, and indeed I asked that question of the officials when they came to the committee, and they accepted that legal proceedings were likely. So why ask our small businesses? Why ask them to go through those hoops? Meet your commitments, Minister. And whilst they won't call on the Minister to go today, because I say it was this Minister and his predecessor, Ms. Foster, collective responsibility, I think, for the shambles today. But I would call him for him to apologise for the mess he has brought to this chamber.
Mr. John McAllister.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I represent one of the constituencies that's going to be very, very heavily affected by this. And part of the Minister's remit is to very often travel around the world and sell Northern Ireland as a place to invest, sell it as a place where we have a skilled workforce and all of the things that we can do. Here we have a scheme that, as Mr. Agnew said, very successful in creating skilled employment, local jobs, and yet meeting very much an environmental obligation as well. We have all of those. We have small companies, some of them subcontractors, maybe just self-employed plumbers working on these other smaller businesses that maybe, as Mr. Alistair named one in his own, or talked about one in his own constituency. I have one in South Down that is £1 million worth of equipment on order for knowing that this scheme, or in the sure and certain knowledge, as they thought, that the government had guaranteed it until the 31st of March.
Where does that business go? When do they start to lay people off? And if this is as bad as many members think, where are we going to stop with redundancies? Is it going to be 1,000? Is it going to be 1,500? Is it going to be 2,000? Certainly.
I thank the member and give him way. Would the member agree with me? It's totally unacceptable. You're talking about job redundancies in the business in South Down, and yet there will be no job redundancies in Delhi. There'll be no one held to account in Delhi through this investigation. And the senior civil servants who are mismanagement by the minister will get off the hook.
Yeah. Not only off the hook, I suspect, Deputy Speaker, maybe even out in the voluntary exit scheme. I think that is the problem that we face. How, if you're running, and many colleagues here over in a previous life ran or have been involved in small businesses, how do you manage that? I mean, it's very often a cash flow that takes businesses down. How do you order £1 million worth of equipment and now find that it's not the 31st of March, it's actually the 29th of February that you have to have worked on? That is impossible to manage and to deal with the scheme. And then I think the very frustrating thing I have to say, Deputy Speaker, to the Minister, is very much related to the points that Mr Agnew made. We look across the water at the rest of the country, and they are managing it and doing it probably, and where there's a supply and demand, a balance that has to be struck, where there's maybe a limit has to be placed on what can be used. Most of us would probably look and go, that seems reasonably sensible. That seems as if we could make and use this scheme and stretch it far beyond and get the maximum benefit out of it. So we end up in the only part of the UK that has to call time on this and call it even earlier than we had hoped to do. I mean, that and all of the problems, of course, associated with that, all of the problems, the businesses that could run into financial hardship, the businesses that don't know now whether they should have been putting some of their workers on notice last Friday or this Friday or whatever Friday it is, all of that uncertainty to the subcontractors, it just makes doing business on a government scheme very, very difficult. And this is exactly the type of business that we're wanting to support, because it's homegrown. It's not going to move to a lower cost base at some point in the future, because it has to be here. And that's something that we should have been supporting from the perspective of the agri-food sector. I mean, could have a huge impact on. Sir,
I'm glad the member referred to the agri-food sector. I'm sure it's coming from the fact that the UFU have been in touch about the potential risk to upwards of 50 projects if this scheme is denied them. But the point I was going to make is, as well, if the member will accept, what this does is for many of those SMEs, it just dissipates, it crashes public confidence in the department and in the executive of an ability to do so effectively, efficiently, and with some degree of dignity and honour. Just crashes it. So I trust the member will take that point.
I am grateful, Deputy Speaker. I do take that point, because why on earth would you at a point in the future enter in or believe in a government commitment or project? You would have to be very almost at a fair degree of suspicion when you would enter into an agreement or see it. It sort of reminds me of the old saying, Deputy Speaker, I'm here from the government and I'm here to help. It would create that level of suspicion as to what is going to happen. And I think that is hugely damaging, not only to Detty's reputation in Northern Ireland, but it is hugely deals a huge blow of confidence to that. And the like of the agri-food sector that had actually was availing of the scheme, was helping to deliver on some of its targets, and could have been used and managed every bit as well as they're doing it in England. And if only the Minister could see, is there no way of tapping in to some of more of that resource in the national target and build on the successes of it? But to stop this effectively a week from now is putting huge pressure on businesses in my constituency and across Northern Ireland. I think that is a huge source of regret. Thank you, Deputy Speaker.
I call the Minister of Enterprise, Trade and Investment, Mr. Jonathan Bell, to conclude and wind up the debate on the motion. Mr. Bell.
Thank you very much, Deputy Speaker. And can I thank all of those who have contributed to today's debate. Energy matters are a major issue for this Assembly, and for local households, and for businesses. Now, a number of issues have been raised today. I'd like to forensically go through those. Everyone has had their say, and let me try and address some of the points that have been made. The Chair, Mr. McClone, raised the issue of the 31st of March 2016. And I hope that everyone will take away, if they take away nothing else, that the 31st of March only applied to tariffs. It did not apply to scheme closure. The only way, and anybody that examines this or looks at the legislation will understand that the only way the scheme can be suspended is through legislation. The 31st of March applied to the tariffs, not to the suspension and ending of the scheme. So that's what I want to be clear on, because I've heard people say that the legislation refers to the 31st of March as a closure date. And I am surprised that the chairman of the committee does not know that that is the case. It is simply not the case. One would have thought he would have known that. One would have thought the QC would have known that. One would have thought Mr. Agnew would have known that. One would have thought anybody that had read the legislation would have known that. So let me say that what the legislation refers to, that people are saying as a closure date, Deputy Speaker, is simply not the case. The reference to the 31st of March is simply the point at which the existing tariff changes to take account of inflation. The legislation provides for the scheme to be ongoing. That is why we need this legislation. Otherwise, the scheme will stay open indefinitely. Now, there has been the question raised by Conor Murphy, Adrian Cochrane-Watson and others about investment, the RHI, money being wasted. I think we need to be clear. The RHI scheme has already resulted in bringing over £50 million of investment into Northern Ireland. We now face a significant pressure going forward, because Treasury will no longer fund the entire RHI. Let me say that again. We face a significant pressure going forward because Treasury will no longer fund the entire RHI. Nonetheless, RHI will still bring something like £130 million into the Northern Ireland economy over the next 5 years. We will have to contribute around £100 million over the next 5 years. But the £130 million is additional investment over and above our block grant. Now, people have asked about timings. I want to refer to a letter that I received through officials, through to the department, dated the 21st of December 2015. It's very clear in that letter that, however, while Her Majesty's Treasury are still considering the funding issue. I think some of the arguments that have been made will go off like snow out of a ditch. When you refer to the facts, to the letter of the 21st of December 2015, that, however, and I quote, while Her Majesty's Treasury are still considering the funding issue. And for those who want to be precisely clear on the energy issue, and the relationship to the fact that March refers to tariffs, let me refer them to 10, where it is very, very clear In the Energy 2015 371 Renewable Heat Incentive Scheme Amendment Regulations, Northern Ireland 2015. If you go to section 10 and you go to issue 3, where it says after paragraph 7, insert, and you go to A, for the period beginning with 18th of November 2015 and ending with 31st of March 2016, are the tariffs. It's in black and white in the legislation that you should have read. And if you haven't read it, you should have read it even from the previous, where you will see that at every stage, even in the 2012 legislation, it refers to tariffs changing on the 31st of March. So anybody with even a cursory examination of the legislation would realise that this does not amount to suspension on the 31st of March. The legislation is very clear. It only refers to tariffs. Now, I want to also go back, because members have made a number of statements, and I don't intend to engage in any of the silly politicking or personal abuse, but I would refer members to the 17th of November 2015 and to the Hansard record, which I will read into the record, that this investment brings benefit in terms of job retention and creation in the energy services sector. Now, listen verbatim to what I said in November 2015. Unfortunately, however, all of that success comes at a cost. Total applications for the Northern Ireland non-domestic scheme are now exceeding our highest estimates. Therefore, we need to look at the full range of cost control measures that have been introduced in GB. Of necessity, that will include measures to curtail the scheme should Treasury funding be restricted. I will take a decision in the light of any announcements in the spending review. A statement I made to this House, which appears not to have been well understood, on the 17th of November 2015. Mr. Dunn asked some questions in relation to timing. And can I say that when I spoke during the debate on the 17th of November 2015 and talked about bringing forward the legislation to limit the RHI tariffs, I said at the time, and I reiterated again what I've read into the record, that I will take a decision in the light of any announcements in the spending review. Now, no one today, given my statement on the 17th of November, should be surprised that the scheme is being suspended. The November spending review, UK, sought to curtail spending, as is now well known. And the letter from the Treasury that I referred to was dated the 13th of January 2016, which was received by the Department on the 15th of January 2016. Official to official engagement ended on the 22nd of December, and the Chief Secretary to the Treasury wrote to our Finance Minister on the 13th of January 2016. 13th of January 2016, to fully outline what the November statement meant for the application of the RHI to Northern Ireland. Now, Deputy Speaker, as we know today, the scheme has enormous budgetary pressures and must be suspended. We simply have no other option. My officials and officials in DFP have exhausted all options in negotiating Treasury, and the scheme must now be suspended. Now, people have raised the issue in relation to fraud. I thought I'd made that clear in my opening remarks. But I think it is clear that the unprecedented increase in demand does indeed require special scrutiny. My department has initiated procurement of additional auditing and checks to supplement the programme of audits that are already completed by Ofgem, who administer the non-domestic scheme. Measures will be taken to ensure that the operation of the scheme is in compliance with the scheme requirements and the underpinning legislation. And I don't think the general public would expect anything less. Conor Murphy raised the issue of allegations of fraud, as have others, including Fergal McKinney. Let me put on the record that we have received anonymous correspondence alleging abuse of the non-domestic scheme. I want to confirm to the House that I brought that to the attention of the scheme administrator to Ofgem. Now, when we look at the management of the scheme, the low members have raised that, the low levels of uptake initially created a £15 million underspend in the first 3 years. Uptake improved in 2015 following promotional campaigns and the introduction of the domestic scheme in December 2014. A sustained increase in applications in the spring was the catalyst for the demand control measures brought forward for the non-domestic scheme in November 2015. However, in the run-up to these changes, there was an unprecedented surge in applications, with over 900 applications received in 6 weeks. This doubled the number of installations on the non-domestic scheme. The increased costs associated with the surge in applications, together with budgetary reductions arising from the November spending review, means the available budgets for new applications has been exceeded. Meeting existing RHI commitments, let alone new ones, will have a very significant impact on the Northern Ireland budget, and that is why both schemes must close. Now, we shouldn't necessarily look away from the success of what these schemes have brought. The RHI has provided homes, businesses, hotels, leisure centres, churches and schools with the opportunity to receive ongoing financial assistance to cover the costs incurred when switching to renewable heating. The RHI has been very successful. It is supporting over 3,500 renewable heating installations. The RHI is an innovative scheme that is designed to support the achievement of 10% renewable heat by 2020. And that is a challenging target considering a baseline position of 1.7%. The Programme for Government interim target of renewable heat by 2015 has not only been met, it has been exceeded. The current estimate suggests 6% has been achieved. By securing increased levels of renewable heating, Northern Ireland becomes more self-sufficient, more energy secure, and it reduces our carbon footprint. The RHI is a positive news story for the Northern Ireland energy market as consumers embrace new technologies, reduce their carbon emissions, and help support the development of this new sector. It has been raised regarding seeking the EDI Committee's approval. And I want members to understand that given the urgency of the situation, I'm seeking this Assembly's approval of the necessary legislation to close both RHI schemes. Regrettably, the situation did not allow time to follow the established convention of seeking the EDI Committee's approval of the policy and draft legislation. I recognise the importance of the Committee's role, but I must take the course of action which addresses the risk to public finances and to seek to progress the necessary legislation that I've laid before you today. So, in answer to what Mr. Agnew brought forward, and I think Mr. Agnew in his statement has a very poor record on renewables. He says, and others say, we've done badly, but we have exceeded our programme for government targets on heat and on renewable energy, electricity. We have exceeded the targets that were set to us by the programme for government. I say 4% was set for heat renewable by 2015. We're at 6%. And the target that was set for us on renewable electricity was 20%, and we've hit 23%. And now that we've exceeded the targets that the programme for government set for us on renewables, is it time for us collectively to bring our wisdom together, to look together at how these schemes and others can be progressed in an affordable way going forward. And in conclusion, Deputy Speaker, I think everyone should consider why the RHI is closing. The Renewable Heat Incentive was introduced in November 2012 to the non-domestic sector and in December 2014 to the domestic sector. And it has been taken up very successfully. As I pointed out earlier, with over 3,500 renewable heating installations incentivised to date, uptake has been higher than GB. We've exceeded the target of 4%, and with around 6% of Northern Ireland's heating now provided through renewable heating technology. Over the last 18 months, the number of non-domestic RHI applications has grown from around 200 to over 1,800. Over 900 applications were received in the run-up to the scheme changes of the 18th of November 2015. However, this together with reductions in available funding means we all have to face up to the significant budgetary pressures. In the circumstances, Deputy Speaker, I have no choice but to propose closure of the scheme to prevent further overspend. The urgent need to manage the financial risk means that legislation must be brought forward at the earliest possible juncture. I commend the motion, Deputy Speaker, to the House.
The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes.
Members will resume their seats, please. Members will resume their seats. The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
Aye.
Do we have tellers? Order, please. Order. I must insist on total silence. Now, that's much better. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Adrian McQuillan and George Robison. Tellers for the noes are Adrian Cochrane-Watson and Fergal McKinney. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left.
Secure the doors. Order. Members will resume their seats, please. Members will resume their seats. Clerk, please read the result.
94 members voted. 60 members voted aye. 34 members voted no. The motion is carried.
The motion is carried. Unfasten the doors.